In this video, I will show how to fix what seems to be a typical problem for Peugeot Boxer, Fiat Ducato and Citroën jumper camper vans or mobilhomes that are less used during the winter months. It has been a few cold days like I just had here, you turn on the ignition and you get an airbag fault light and a check airbag error message. Airbag errors can often be related to bad contacts or shorts in various sensors. But this particular case is a bit more mysterious. I have not been able to find the definitive explanation for why this happens, but since it's mostly camper vans and mobilhomes that are affected during winter, two hypotheses are that it's either related to a low battery, as the battery discharges when they're standing still, or to condensation forming on the contacts of the airbag circuit, leading to shorts and thus faulty behavior. For my situation, I am pretty sure it's not caused by a low battery, as my starter battery is kept fully charged via solar panels. It is now the second time I have this particular problem, the previous time being during the winter 2 years ago. Back then, I had to go to a mechanic to get the error read out over the onboard diagnostic port to confirm the so-called B0100 error. They will charge you around 50 euros to do that, and they will tell you that they can't clear it. These days, I have my own diagnostic tools, so I can demonstrate the error code readout process. As you can see, the battery was more than 14 volts when the error was logged, but it could be that it was already detected earlier in the airbag controller and it was only communicated to the car's computer after I started the van and the alternator was running. Sadly, trying to clear the error results in failure. The problem is that the fault is stored in an internal flash chip of the airbag controller, and you do not have access to that chip via the diagnostic port. So fixing it involves a bit of electronics and software tinkering. Start by disconnecting the starter battery, and also disconnect the path from your leisure battery to the starter battery if you have that, because it is essential that the airbag controller is really powered down, or you risk that it thinks it is in a crash or something and blows the airbags. Also for that reason, after disconnecting all power sources, wait for about half an hour before the next step to make sure all internal capacitors have been completely discharged. If you are parked on a public street and you need to be able to lock the car during the wait time, what worked for me was the following sequence. Get in the car with the battery still connected, close all doors, lock all doors with the remote or the button on the dash, disconnect the battery, open the driver's side door with the lever, exit the car and lock the driver's side door with the physical key. After the wait time, continue by taking off this panel at the bottom. There are two screws that have to be removed first, and then you can just pull it off. You now have access to the three bolts that mount this box, which is the airbag controller, to the floor. Unscrew them so you can lift the controller out. Then you can unclip the two connectors, so you can start working on the controller board itself. On a side note, if the next section is a bit too daunting, know that there are some companies that offer to clear the error codes for you, if you send them the controller unit. Since it is likely you will run into this problem a few times during the lifetime of your van, might be interesting though to learn how to do it yourself to save you some time and money. Anyway, here we go. Remove all the screws so you can take off the cover to get to the main board. The EEPROM flash chip containing the error codes we want to clear is located right there, the chip with the 8 legs, an M95640 from ST. It might be possible to program it while leaving it on the board, but I am not sure what the processor will do when we put power on the 3V lines. If it starts booting and accessing the chip at the same time as we are trying to access it, we will get collisions and read and write errors. So the safest is to take it off the board and work with it in a controlled environment. It might be possible to remove it with the soldering iron with white tips so you can heat the leg simultaneously, but I will just use my hot air station to keep life simple. Once the chip is off, you can use an adapter such as these to mount the chip and to easily connect to its pins. I will leave a link to such an adapter in the comments. Now to reprogram it, you have specialized programmers for these EEPROM chips, but there is little point in buying something like that when you can just do it with, for instance, a Raspberry Pi. Other boards like an ESP32 are also possible, you just need something that supports SPI. I will continue with the Raspberry Pi here since I assume this is the one most people have access to. I'm using a version 4B, but it does not really matter. To connect the Pi to the adapter board, we need to hook up 6 wires as shown in the picture. The chip has 8 pins, but 3 of them are all connected to the 3V3. You also need to add a pull-up resistor, mine is hidden in the glue in my connector, between the chip select line and the 3V3 to make sure it goes high to deselect the chip as soon as the power comes on. Otherwise, if there is some jitter on the lines, the chip might think that it's actually a write command and the contents might get corrupted. After making such a cable, we are ready to talk to the chip. I have modified some code to easily read and write the contents of the chip, since I could not find anything that worked out of the box. I will add a link to the code in the description. I have listed the commands you need to execute here, I will also put them in the comments. First, you need to enable the SPI 0 peripheral with one chip select line on GPIO 8. This matches the pins to which we have connected the EEPROM chip. Then, if you have not yet done so before, compile the code to talk to the chip. Then, read the current contents of the chip. If you get errors at this point, probably there is a bad contact somewhere in your wiring. Now you have to inspect the values you just read back. If you have the same controller as I do, then there will be some kind of header section at the top, then a bunch of zeros, and then the area to which he writes false. If there are no faults present, this area is all cleared with hex FF values. But in my case, this is where we see a few fields with other values. I already prepared a file where I reset these fields to all Fs again. If your layout is completely different, then it is best to ask for help on car forums to know where exactly the fault data is saved by your controller. It is definitely not a good idea to just randomly try and reset some values. If you are confident you have the good values, it's time to write them to the chip. And, as a sanity check, read them back again to make sure we indeed have cleared the fault values. I would also advise to back up the flash content somewhere, so you have a good reference when the problem happens again in, let's say, 2 years, or to help someone else out. With the chip now in a good state, time to make some room. And resolder it on the board again. I was not sure I had enough solder left on the pads, so I tried spreading some fresh solder paste. But this actually made quite a mess with balls of solder creating shorts between the legs. So I had to use a soldering wick to clean everything up. But in the end, everything seemed to look fine. To verify, I first did a continuity test to make sure none of the pins were shorted. Well, except for the 3 pins connected to the 3V3, of course. And I also checked that the pins were really soldered onto the board by doing a continuity test between the top of the pin and some vias on the board leading to those pins. Better be safe than sorry. I decided to apply conforma coating on the board, which it does not have from the factory. This is, in case the problem is indeed related to condensation occurring on this board, then the coating should help prevent problems in the future. Only time will tell. After that, it's just a matter of reassembling everything. And then mounting it all back in the van. Reattaching the battery. And then finally, the big moment of truth, turning on the ignition. If you did everything correctly, the airbag error would clear itself. There is no need for a diagnostic tool to clear it.